In 1914, a whole generation is drawn into the world's first mass war. 70 million men from over 20 countries will be called up to do military service. As they enlist in the new mass armies, they become numbers in a war of numbers. And over the next 4 years, more men will be slaughtered more quickly for less gain than in any war so far. When the war broke out in August 1914, no one could know what was coming. In the capitals of Europe, there was a mood of patriotic excitement.
Es war eine Hurra-Stimmung sondergleichen.
Everyone was wildly enthusiastic. They were all waving flags. People threw flowers at the soldiers, and they stuck them into the end of their rifles. They were given cigarettes and chocolates. Their mothers or wives ran along beside them, and everyone was singing, "We will meet again in the homeland."
In der Heimat, da gibt's ein Wiedersehen.
Each nation hoped to gain from the war. They had alliances to honor, old scores to settle.
All over the world, there are young fellows who say the war is just an adventure, and it's our country, and it's patriotism, and it's partly to get decorations. It's a mix. It's a mix, and it's wonderful because you get away from family and so on. You're all of a sudden on your own. At 18 or 19 or 20, which is great.
The French had feared German aggression for years. Now they hoped the threat could be ended once and for all.
We really believed that the French army would perform miracles, that it would reach Berlin in 48 hours, no more than that.
48 heures à Berlin, rien ne nous étonnait.
We didn't think for one moment that the war would go on for so long, or that it would be so cruel.
Everywhere, people believed what their leaders told them, that they would be better off after the fighting, and that the soldiers would be back soon. In St. Petersburg, Russians were mobilized to fight for the Tsar. In Vienna, the soldiers of Austria-Hungary were ready to fight for the Habsburg Empire. At the start of the war, Britain was the only country that still relied on volunteers. But men flocked to the colours, fearing they'd miss a war that could be over by Christmas.
The atmosphere, it was certainly electric, but almost unbelievable. We now were excited about it and all ready to join in, because everything had been rather, too peaceful almost until that time. The country was overrun by volunteers in such numbers that I don't think the government could deal with them for a long time.
Mobilization plans that had taken years to prepare were implemented quickly. It was war by timetable. Special train schedules dispatched millions of men to the fronts with all the industrial efficiency modern governments could command. As men were absorbed into the new mass armies, their individual dreams and personal ambitions were put aside. The war soon took on a world scale, as European countries turned to their overseas empires to raise even more troops. 300,000 men left from Australia alone. And to help Britain, more came from New Zealand, South Africa, and Canada.
In Australia at that time, we were part of the British Empire and were very loyal to Britain. We felt it was our war. It's a bit different today, perhaps, but at that time, that was the feeling. Apart from which, if you stayed a year or too long, you'd have got a white feather from the girls. No, it was a thing to do.
More than 100,000 Indians were hurriedly shipped over. On arrival in France, they were issued with woolen underwear. Chakunga came from a village on the Burmese border.
I wanted to take part in the British government's war.
I wanted to see Western countries for myself. We were told they were healthy places.
The French imported contract workers from China to do heavy labor. They dealt with them briskly. More soldiers came from French colonies in Africa. And after 3 years, the war would bring in the world's strongest nation.
Your Uncle Sammy needs you one and all. Answer to his call. It's your country, it's mine.
4 million young Americans would be rapidly drafted when the United States ended its neutrality in 1917. Many were as keen to go as Albert Powys.
I liked America. I guess I was patriotic. Because every time I heard the band play a good marching song, why, I'd have cold chills run up and down my back.
A disproportionately high number of troops were black Americans. The government told all recruits they were entering the war to defend democracy.
I'd never heard of democracy before. I never knew what the hell I was fighting for. All I knew, I liked the uniform and I wanted to be in the army.
It's your country, it's my country, with millions of real fighting men.
With little idea of what they would have to face, troops leaving New York Harbor laughed off their fears with gallows humor.
In addition, we saw Statue of Liberty. And we had a bunch of comics on the show, on the boat, you know, and one of them said, did you hear what that statue's saying to you? And we said, no. He's saying, that's your ass, big boy, that's your ass. That means you're never coming back. You're gone.
Shakespeare's the greatest writer who ever lived. Who wouldn't want to know what made him tick?
Shakespeare Week starts tomorrow at 10 on UK TV History.
I'm Matt, and this is the first time I've decorated this room.
I could go for painting as a job.
Here's my mate Tony. What's your verdict?
Have you got enough paint?
And this is the first time I've ever got my benefit out of my bank account at the post office.
With direct payment, you can now get your benefit or pension paid into a bank account that lets you get cash out at the post office.
Excuse me, sir. You left your camera here?
For more information, call 0800 107 2000. Direct payment, giving it to you straight.
This is an urgent appeal on behalf of the British Red Cross. Across the world, millions of people in desperate need look to the Red Cross for help. They look to the Red Cross for such things as food, water, shelter, and medicine. Things most of us take for granted. But without regular donations of £2 a month, much of this help would stop. A regular donation of £2 a month may not sound like much, but to many sick, hungry, and homeless people, it can mean the difference between life and death. Please, give £2 a month to the British Red Cross, or as much as you can afford. Just call 0800 083 5000. By giving £2 a month, you will help us save lives. So please, call 0800 083 5000 now. Thank you.
Sesame seeds, gently toasted to bring out the flavor. Open sesame.
In the future, everyone's glasses will automatically adjust to changing light and block out harmful UV rays that can damage the eyes. But for those with transitions lenses, the future is already here. Ask your optician, because the danger is real now, and so is the protection. Transitions, right in any light.
Come on, we're here! Lockie!
Quick, the door!
There he goes, Dad!
If you're a safe driver, More Than Car Insurance lets you protect your maximum claim discount and keep it protected for life, however many bumps or scrapes you have.
Dad!
In fact, More Than promised that your premium will never go up just because you've made a claim.
That's lucky. That's more than lucky.
Car insurance, don't accept less than More Than. Call 0800 300 202. It's a real winner.
Please help us save lives. Call 0800 083 5000 now and give £2 a month to the British Red Cross.
Sometimes the best man for the job is a woman. All new Alias Series 3 tonight at 9 exclusively on Bravo.
Against the mass armies, a new generation of weapons was to be put into the field. What the new guns had in common was the capacity to kill more men faster. Machine guns could now fire 600 rounds a minute. But despite the new weapons, training was still based on the military manuals of the past. Suggestions for dealing with new obstacles like barbed wire were inadequate. Private Walter Hare wasn't impressed.
To scrapper good. I was trained at West Hartlepool. I learned how to salute officers, which seemed to be the main thing in the army. I learned to slope arms and present arms, which you can't do in a muddy trench. I fired 5 rounds before I went out to France. I never saw a grenade. I never saw a machine gun. So I was a rookie when I went to France.
Walter Hare was part of the British Army that was now joined with France and Russia against Germany, Austria-Hungary and Turkey. A great arc of fighting encircled the Central Powers. There were fronts to the east. The south, Italy would come in later, as well as the fighting in the west. In the first months, the experience of war for ordinary soldiers was little different from previous wars. A succession of rapid marches took the Germans across Belgium into northern France, where the French and British tried to stop them. In a rare piece of early film, British cavalry were seen moving across open ground, as they'd always done. But they'd come under observation from German gunners. The camera was turning at the moment the target was hit by high explosives. After only a few months of the war, it became clear that modern artillery was so powerful and accurate that tactics had to change. Both sides had to take up defensive positions. And for the soldiers, this meant that the central experience of the war would change into a long and bloody battle of attrition. both sides started digging trenches, all the way from the Channel, through northeastern France, down to the Swiss border. The British and French on one side,
fighting for the French, then invade Blitz and bombed on Canada,
and a few hundred yards away, the Germans. As the front lines were strengthened and completed, networks of support trenches and then communications trenches were cut across the countryside. Signalers laid telephone wires to link the front with the artillery and headquarters behind. It was the start of a long deadlock. In this half-buried war, defending a position was much easier than taking the enemy's. Men kept below the parapet, but both sides watched the other constantly. And snipers peered through their steel spy holes to shoot anything that moved. The Germans believed all they had to do was to stay put on the territory they'd taken. They dug elaborate bunkers to protect themselves from the shelling and waited. Cut by hand or with power drills, their human burrows could go down 50 meters with several levels. There were underground kitchens, sleeping quarters, and sick bays. Some had electricity and water. Allied soldiers admired the Germans' thoroughness.
They were much better organized and harder working than we were. We were an offensive army, whereas they wanted to hold on to what they'd got. They'd built tunnels, which we saw when we were advancing. Each one housed 40 or 50 men. They were really plush.
Parts of the front were quiet for months at a time. A French private wrote, "We have become waiting machines. For the moment, it is food we're waiting for. Then it will be the post. After that, we shall set ourselves to wait for something else."
In the early days, of course, there were so many boring days and very little fighting. I used to do a lot of sketching. It filled the time, and I got ideas from whatever happened the day before. A listening patrol would be sent out occasionally to get as close as possible to the German trench and to pick up any sort of information that might have been given you by Germans talking amongst themselves. And one just thought of a German champing away and making a noise while he ate.
Behind the lines, teams of butchers, cooks and bakers labored to feed the soldiers.
Oh, hell, what bloody big lumps of beef! Oh, hell, what
British Empire troops were meant to have fresh meat regularly, but most days it was tinned stew, corned beef, dried biscuits.
Bloody big lumps, bloody big lumps!
The German soldiers' food was poorer. They always had army bread, but other supplies were cut as the Allied blockade of German ports tightened. They had to supplement their rations as best they could.
Of course there was always hunger. We ate on our dark soldiers' bread artificial honey, but it wasn't bad. There were a lot of horses killed, and of course then we had a lot of horse meat. It looked funny when there was a dead horse. A troop passed by, and 10 minutes afterwards there was nothing but the bones left, because everybody put a piece of meat into his pocket to cook it in the evening, or give it to the goulash gun, to give it to the fellow who made us the soup. And the soup, there was mostly dried vegetables, which we called barbed wire, it was so hard. But if you put a piece of meat, of horse meat in there, it tasted after something.
It was a battle of industrial might as well as manpower. The ordering and transporting of the guns and munitions took military planning and logistics to new levels. Of the war, the Germans had over 20,000 heavy guns, with a network of repair centers to maintain them. In the depots on the Allied side, much of the heavy work was done by colonial troops. They were used to the heat of the summer, but they'd not experienced European winters.
The hardest time was when we were at the station and it was snowing. I'd not seen snow before, it was unbearable. Some people just froze up and had to be carried away. We put on 4 layers of clothing, then a big coat on top of that. But with all these clothes on, we couldn't work very fast.
On the longer fronts in the east, the two sides were less evenly matched, and there was more movement. Russian troops were thrown back by the Germans after a huge battle at the outset in East Prussia, but had more success against the Austrians. As the fighting ranged over hundreds of miles, the poorly led peasant armies of Russia suffered rising casualties. By the end of 1914, half the men who'd gone to war that summer were already dead or wounded. Hospital trains donated by patriotic Russian princesses backed up the inadequate army medical service. Max Kleinman was wounded in the chest and taken, filthy from the battlefield, onto one of the trains.
Но на следующий день я проснулся, а передо мною...
I woke up the next day. I'd been unconscious. When I saw a pretty nurse, I began to revive. I called, "Nurse." She was too scared to come near me because lice were crawling all over me. The male nurses had to do all the dirty jobs,
because these young girls weren't used to the conditions.
There were lice on the Western Front too. Men who were accustomed to keeping clean when they were at home found the weeks of squalor demoralizing.
When we come out of the line, there were big army baths, steam baths, and you went in there and you passed in all your clothing. You had a hot bath and you came out and you got new issue of clothing, different clothing. That was supposed, of course, to be lice-free, but the steam laundry didn't kill the eggs. And round the armpit where the lice used to lay their eggs, we used to just strip, pull them off and light a cigarette, or if we could get out of a cigarette or a cigar, that was better, and just burn the eggs. You just put them on, and the eggs would explode. And you'd just singe the singlet shirt. That didn't matter, but that killed the eggs and the lice, and you had a free go for a while until you got back and got infested again from the surroundings.
The cards and letters they sent home were censored. But in any case, soldiers found it difficult to tell their families about the real privations of the war.
Le 17 septembre 1916, ma chère maman,
17th of September. Dear mother, I'm well and I hope you are too. I got your parcel yesterday. I was really pleased as food is scarce at the moment. Everything is very much the same here, in other words, pretty nasty. Longing to hear from you. Meanwhile, I send you both a big kiss. Your son, who thinks of you often.
Marcel.
To stiffen the will to win, mass propaganda was used for the first time.
This propaganda, they told us about them killing women and children and one thing and another. They had a lot of propaganda about that there. The Hun, you know, they called him. And how he'd go through these villages when he'd capture them and kill all the people off and that there. That's the stuff that they told us. To feed you up, to get you mad, I guess.
Atrocities alleged to have been committed by the Germans in Belgium were presented in melodramatic form.
We were furious about this slander. We always said that it was evil propaganda, and we felt that we Germans were powerless to answer back.
Is there some new procedure I don't know about?
Oh my God! Jumpstart your week, and My Family Double, tomorrow from 9 on UK TV Gold.
A Cordula automatic sun canopy makes lovely sunny days even more enjoyable. When not required, it simply disappears. Cordula puts you in control with quality construction built to last for years and a superb choice of colours and styles to suit your home. For a brochure, call Freephone Cordula on 0800 018 3399. Stay cooler with Cordula. Call 0800 018 3399 now.
Figure you want. Surely there's a simpler way. Relax, exercise gently, and of course eat sensibly. Special K, it's as simple as A, B, K.
This is not hair color as usual.
This is New Color Expert from L'Oreal. Multitonal hair color, full of actual natural highs and lows. Step one, deep conditioning base color. Step two, personally placed harmonized highlights for multitonal color, as individual as you are. New Color Expert from L'Oreal Paris.
Doing things like washing your car yourself might save a few pounds, but if you want an easier way to save, you could do it on phone bills by signing up to Tele2, free on 0800 027 8080. Switching to Tele2 is easy. There's no need to change your phone, BT line or number. With Tele2, peak calls are only 2.5p per minute, and off-peak calls are less than 1p per minute. You get a high-quality service enjoyed by over 20 million people in 23 countries. It's so easy, anyone can do it. Call free now on 0800 027 8080. And you could too. Tele2, why pay more?
I'm not getting in that!
I can't afford a new car.
Hiya.
Hi, Jen.
Why don't you try Direct Line?
They do my car cover.
They do loans too.
That's how I got my new kitchen.
A Direct Line loan is an easy way to borrow up to £25,000 at really competitive rates based on your circumstances and loan amount. Just call 0800 068 3838 or apply online. That's 0800 068 3838 for a low-cost loan for almost anything. Or apply online.
History, like time, doesn't stand still. With each new discovery, our perceptions change. Every month, BBC History magazine throws new light on our past. The new discoveries, the latest research, revealing how history is shaping our modern world. BBC History magazine, where history comes to life.
Relive the days that shook the world and shaped the 20th century. Weeknights at 11 on UKTV Documentary.
Soldiers on both sides were exposed to the greatest dangers when attempts were made to break the stalemate and get the armies moving again. The British and French commanders dreamt of one great breakthrough. In 1916, they planned their biggest operation yet, which would concentrate a massive barrage on just one section of the German lines, near the River Somme. 1.5 million shells were taken up to the gun batteries in preparation. Shrapnel shells packed with lead balls would rip through flesh and bring maximum casualties. High explosive would smash German bunkers. For 7 days around the clock, the British artillery pulverized the German trenches, while fresh troops waited to rush through the gap they expected to blast in the lines. The thunder of the barrage was heard on the other side of the English Channel. A British general said, "It's all a question of killing a sufficient number of Boche." As the shells crashed above their heads, the Germans stayed in their dugouts, cut deep into the chalk. To help the artillery hit their targets, aircraft flew over the battlefield. Before the introduction of radio, they had to drop messages to their own gunners. One of the pilots who flew patrols was Cecil Lewis.
We'd know when they were going to fire. We'd watch and see the pop of the gun going off. We'd watch, you know, to see the bursts of the shell falling, and it fell, and we knew it was it over, was it behind, was it to the left, was it to the right, and that in that rudimentary way we ranged the guns, you know, one at a time, and the battery had four guns, so it took a whole patrol of 2 hours to range those four guns on one objective, so you could see what a primitive thing it was, and why, in fact, it ended up by everybody just pooping off their guns for all they were worth until the whole battlefront was absolutely one solid mass of bursting shells. It was just like a field of snow.
Our After 20,000 tons of shells had rained down on the German positions, the British prepared to attack, confident there'd be no enemy left. One battalion was told, you can slope arms, light up your pipes, and march all the way to Pozières before meeting any live Germans. As the barrage lifted, the attack began.
I climbed out, got through the wire, and we're crossing no man's land when machine guns opened out on us and some of our chaps were dropping down the side of me.
100,000 troops set out, but the shelling had failed to destroy the wire. The Germans came out from their deep dugouts and mowed down the advancing men. We were surprised to see them walking, a machine gunner said. We just had to load and reload. You didn't have to aim, you just fired into them. Walter Hare managed to get to the German lines.
Kept going, I got to the German barbed wire, I got through that, all right. And jumped into a German trench. We stayed there all that day and the following night. With no food, no water, getting short of ammunition. But one of our chaps from headquarters came forward to us and he said, oh, I'm bringing orders for you. You've got to retire to the trenches you left as best you can, get back as best you can. So I finished up there where I left. I think there were 230 odd casualties and we never gained a yard of ground. I'd lost a lot of my pals that we needed them. I thought how stupid it was.
By the end of the first day, 20,000 Britons had been killed and 40,000 wounded. The commanders continued to order fresh attacks for 3 months, long after it was clear that a breakthrough was impossible. To the troops, it seemed their leaders were remote and out of touch.
The trouble was that the people who gave these orders for the attacks were in a chateau 10 miles behind the line. Had never been to the trenches. They didn't know what the conditions were like.
The German High Command ordered counter-attacks. It was their soldiers' turn to go over the top.
When I clambered out of the trench along with my comrades, the feeling of fear disappeared.
Ausspringen muss, rausklettern muss. Dann vergeht das Gefühl der Angst. Dann hat man das, die innere.
You felt it was your duty to advance with the others, not to leave them in the lurch.
Zusammen vorzugehen und den nächsten nicht im Stich zu lassen. Das Gefühl der Angst kommt.
You only feel fear when you hear enemy mortars whizzing right past you.
Infanteriegeschosse in unmittelbarer Nähe an einem vorbei, einem pfeifen hört.
Then, without thinking, you automatically throw yourself down on the ground.
Unbewusst wirft man sich auf die Erde.
Modern science added further to the agony with poison gas. The Germans used it first. The British and French followed. Artillerymen wore masks to fire the canisters, first making sure the wind was blowing in the right direction.
There was a terrific bombardment going on somewhere, and then this gas caught my throat. And I thought, oh God, gas. And I felt like doing nothing but taking to my heels and running away, trying to get away from this insidious cloud of gas which was creeping quietly over the ground. You could see it moving just slightly over the ground. And all the time I was getting this awful gas into the throat and lungs.
The effects of phosgene gas came on slowly. The eyes and throat smarted. Then the pain worsened. It took up to 48 hours to die from drowning as the lungs filled with liquid. But most casualties were from bullets and shells.
High explosives, when they detonated, they'd explode and there'd be pieces of metal, perhaps 8 or 10 inches long, jagged. They, without any trouble at all, could cut a man's head right off, a leg cut off, an arm cut off, a chest exposed. There were some horrible wounds from this type of shells.
Ted Smart was a stretcher bearer collecting the wounded from the battlefield.
There were no painkillers, tablets or painkillers we know them today. They didn't exist. Chloroform was only used on the seriously wounded for any necessary surgery. Other than that, they just had to tolerate it. I saw one man, the whole of his stomach was open, and he was. And this doctor just took the whole bowel of the stomach right out and just put cotton wool back, a bit of cotton wool, and put it back into place. He was only trying to make the man comfortable. He died. There was no hope for him.
If the wounded survived the long journey back from no man's land, they were treated at hospitals behind the lines. The operating room starts at about 8:30 a.m., wrote a French surgeon, and four tables are going steadily until 1 o'clock at night. We've done 273 operations in 4 days. One British soldier was looked after by a young French girl.
Et depuis deux jours, il est mourant et il attend sa mère.
He'd been dying for 2 days, waiting for his mother.
Absolument bouleversé, c'est terrible. Et il a senti qu'il y avait quelqu'un.
I sat with this boy, feeling totally overwhelmed with grief. It was terrible, but he must have felt that there was a woman beside him, because he stretched out his poor hands.
Là, je ne sais pas ce qui m'a pris, surtout de la part d'un enfant, mais j'avais été bouleversé.
I was so overcome that I thought, he's waiting for his mother. And I am going to give him the kiss he's waiting for. It never crossed my mind to ask what his name was. I never forgot him. I kissed him, and he died.
Shakespeare's the greatest writer who ever lived. Who wouldn't want to know what made him tick?
Shakespeare Week starts tomorrow at 10 on UK TV History.
My cholesterol dropped to 4.8.
My LDL cholesterol dropped by 12%.
Over 10 million people in 21 countries have been using Flora Proactive, which contains a plant extract clinically proven to lower cholesterol. Now there are two new ways to enjoy Flora Proactive. In refreshing milk and tasty yogurt. Flora Proactive, now in milk and yogurt.
For tough cleaning, Cif. Who else? Now available, Cif Oxygel Wild Orchid.
Now the DVLA don't need to look here for out-of-date tax discs. They don't even need to look here or here. If your car tax is out of date or if you haven't declared your car as off the road, there's only one place the DVLA now need to look. Here. And if you aren't up to date, the database will automatically issue an £80 penalty. Here. The new car tax rules. Are you up to date?
Doing things like washing your car yourself might save a few pounds, but if you want an easier way to save, you could do it on phone bills by signing up to Tele2, free on 0800 027 8080. Switching to Tele2 is easy. There's no need to change your phone, BT line or number. With Tele2, peak calls are only 2.5p per minute, and off-peak calls are less than 1p per minute. You get a high-quality service enjoyed by over 20 million people in 23 countries. It's so easy, anyone can do it. Call free now on 0800 027 8080. And you could too. Tele2, why pay more?
Sometimes the best man for the job is a woman. All new Alias Series 3, tonight at 9, exclusively on Bravo.
In the same year as the Somme, the Germans had made their own effort to end the stalemate and win the war. They aimed to slaughter as many French troops as they could. At Verdun, in northeast France, they launched an attack on a group of strategic forts, knowing the French would do everything to defend them. And once drawn in, the German commander predicted, "The forces of France will bleed to death." Hundred German guns pounded an 8-mile stretch of the French front. The trap worked. The French ordered that Verdun be held at all costs, and division after division was thrown into battle. France was desperate for men. Older and older age groups were sent to the front. As they passed headquarters on their way towards Verdun, some bleated like sheep. One unit was told, "You have a mission of sacrifice. On the day the Germans choose, they will massacre you to the last man, and it is your duty to fall." When the French resistance was strengthened with big guns, the Germans too had to pour in more and more men. Now they were being bled themselves. Second Lieutenant Ernst Weckeling was pinned down by French artillery in a bomb crater.
It was hell. The air was full of the smoke and fumes from the constant firing of the French guns. The crater I was in was so deep that it was impossible for any breeze to blow the fumes away. The air was so bad that we were parched with thirst, and breathing was very difficult. I had to remove everything from the dead bodies, from their breast pockets, their trouser pockets. I had to find the ID tags on their chests and remove them. I felt like a butcher sometimes as I rummaged around in all that blood. On some corpses, the whole torso had been flattened by mortars, and pieces of flesh were hanging everywhere.
Verdun marked a further stage in the dehumanization of the soldiers in the Great War. After 10 months and 700,000 French and German casualties, the front line was almost exactly where it had been at the start. And Verdun was a reeking quagmire, littered with human remains.
Alors, We had to jump from corpse to corpse. If we stepped in the mud on either side, we'd get stuck. But we had to use the corpses lying face down, because if we landed on their stomachs, our feet would sink in, which was disgusting. It was terrible. We were surrounded by death.
At Verdun, at the Somme, and in Flanders, the combination of slaughter, human despair, and mud became the pivotal experience of the war.
The whole area is mud. It was pockmarked with shell holes. There wasn't a piece of ground that was virgin. Just a wasteland, I mean, as far as you could see. That would be the worst. There was nothing ever to compare with it, as far as I'm concerned. Wounded lying in the mud and sinking into the mud and not able to get out and not able to get to him. And that would happen quite a lot. There were a lot of men drowned in the mud in Passchendaele.
The nightmare of the killing fields tested the discipline of all the mass armies. Some soldiers try to find their own way of getting home.
I saw one of our battalion lads laid out on the ground on top of the parapet with his legs up in the air. And I said, what are you trying on? He said, well, I'm trying to get a wound if I can in my legs. He said, there's quite a bit of machine gunning going on and a few rifle fires. He said, I thought I might get a bullet through my leg and get home to Blighty, which of course meant to get home to England. He said, I can't stand any more. I'm absolutely at the far end, I'm done for. I said, we all feel like that. He says, no, you don't feel like me. I said, we do, every one of us, but we've a job to do. We're going to do it.
Many of the men caught up in the barbarities of industrialized warfare were better educated than any soldiers before them. But though they were more informed, they were in no better position to question the orders they were given. The penalties for refusing to fight or for deserting were harsh. In the British Army, they were applied to men who were visibly reeling from shell shock. Anyone who disobeyed orders faced court-martial. Private Arthur Earp was found in a dugout when he should have been attacking. Like more than 300 others, he was sentenced to death. On his appeal papers, General Haig wrote, "How can we ever win if this plea is allowed?" It was in the French army that soldiers finally refused to put up with it anymore. In spring 1917, after huge losses in another failed offensive, morale snapped, and men in half the divisions of the army mutinied. One declared, "We are men, and not beasts to be led to the abattoir to be slaughtered." For weeks, the army was in ferment. The French commanders realized they must change tactics. After this, no more pointless attacks were ordered, but 55 mutineers were shot. On the Eastern Front, Russian troops lost all faith in their leaders after more than 2 million men had been killed, and they heard of unrest at home. After news of the October Revolution in St. Petersburg, the Russians stopped fighting, and soldiers on both sides climbed out of their trenches to fraternize. Discipline broke down, and Russian soldiers set up revolutionary committees. Deserters threatened officers who tried to stand in their way.
Очень просто, понимаете, ушел я, потом только не только что я ушел один. Все уходили.
I wasn't the only one, though. Everyone was leaving. There was no keeping us there because the army had already completely disintegrated. Everyone had had enough of the war, and everyone was deserting.
In the West, the stalemate was ended partly by the arrival of more and more American troops, unwearied by war. It was too much for the battered and blockaded Germans. Realizing they'd never win against these odds, they accepted an armistice, which amounted to a surrender. The bright promises of 1914 had never been fulfilled. Though the Germans were humiliated, no one side gained the glory or the clear victory they'd been led to expect at the start. But 9 million died in a new kind of warfare in which the slaughter was mechanized, industrialized, inescapable. The world could never return to the certainties of 1914. Four empires were overthrown as the war ended. But the psychological scars were just as great. In the post-war world, few could ever again believe that war like this could have any justification. Suspicious of politicians and generals, the survivors were determined not to be led this way again.